Hello, anyone there? Hi, if you're live in the chat, and can you quickly say a little thing in the chat box and just introduce yourself? Just say hello. Hi, I'm Rupert, by the way. Anyone there? No one there yet? Oh, I can see the three of you. Alice, Ashraf, and Cassandra. If you just find the chat box at the bottom, it says Q&A. And just make sure you type your name into there, just so we know that it's all working. Everyone okay on that? How are you doing? How are they doing, T? Cool, everyone's here, lovely, welcome. So my name's Rupert, I work in the School of English and Drama. And welcome to this little quick and quite informal online chat about starting at Queen Mary University of London. If you have any questions, I'll wait through how you found the chat box before. That's how you can ask questions. And we have a student ambassador, T. Do you want to say hello?
Hi.
They can hear you. and she will either let me know or she'll answer your question directly now. So it's a really good chance to ask anything that you're worried about or thinking about in the run-up to starting at Queen Mary. So we're really excited you're thinking of coming to study with us. And I thought I'd go through some quick bit of the sort of really boring stuff to begin with, and then we'll do a bit of a Q&A with English, a bit of an intro to English, a bit of an intro to drama, and then we'll do a bit about student support and extra stuff you can do at Queen Mary. So I'll just move my presentation. Oh, I forgot that I have to get up. Cool. So I'll start at the end, actually, weirdly. Today was our graduation. So we had lots of lovely students graduating in our great hall. And so it's a bit of a weird day to be both saying goodbye to students and saying hello to you guys, which is pretty exciting for us. So these are our students all graduating today, very happy. These are real students who have had a nice 3 years with us, hopefully. And I'll just keep moving. So if everyone can answer this question in the chat box, so use the Q&A box. And just say, who's here for English and who's here for drama? You just type English in the box or drama in the box. Cool, how's it going? Are people doing that? Anyone still there? Oh, here we go. There's some coming up. So who have we got?
We have Alice and
a nun. And do we know what subjects they're studying?
Two for English.
Two for English and none for drama. So that'll be fun for the drama section. We'll basically, what's going to happen if no one's here for drama, we'll keep going. So maybe English people have a little snooze or get your music back on. And then after that, we will go back to the stuff around student support and things that you might actually want to know. So if you're doing English and drama, both will be easy to kind of answer as well. Let me just move my presentation. Cool, so I'm just going to talk a little bit about the confirmation process. So, results day is Thursday. I think I may have got this date wrong, so that's really going to help everyone. So it's actually Thursday the 15th of August. So the 16th is wrong, it's Thursday the 15th of August, and that is when confirmation happens. So you've currently probably got you've firmed your offer, either an unconditional offer or a conditional offer. And what will happen is you'll get your results on that day if you're doing A-levels and due to get your results this year. And then we'll send a thing saying your place is confirmed. And that's what confirmation is. And it will happen automatically if you've got an unconditional offer on that day. If you've got a conditional offer and you meet your grades, it will also happen automatically. So you'll get a little email saying, welcome to Queen Mary. Weeks after your place has been confirmed, and that's really important that you start kind of checking in that account, because stuff around your accommodation or any other things to do with your university place will start being sent there rather than to your personal email. We'll also send your welcome week timetable on results day, so keep an eye on your email. Make sure your email address is up to date in UCAS as well. Cool, here's some key dates. I'll send around this presentation later, so there's no need to sort of take notes or anything. The key one that you need to remember, and please don't be away for, is the 16th to the 20th of September, which is Welcome Week. And that is a chance for you to meet other students. That's probably the most important thing. get an introduction to the subject that you're going to study, but also, to have fun and explore the campus and explore kind of all the different things you can get involved with at Queen Mary. So it's a really important week, especially for first years. Let's keep going. So we have general contacts as well. So that's your email, Instagram, Twitter, Facebook. There's loads of ways to contact us, and we're really happy to help you in any of these forms. That's the next one. These are year tutors, so and sort of support, your main sources of support in the first year for English. So you have your Alfred Hyatt, who's the first year tutor for English. That's his email address. Also, there's a drama support tutor, Martin O'Brien, who will be available as well to answer questions. And you can also chat with students live on UniBuddy, which is a platform you might have used already, but you're very welcome in the run-up to starting to keep using it. So I think that's all from me for now, but we will have a little bit more from me in a bit about student support, extracurricular activities, and some other kind of housekeeping stuff. But for now, that's it from me. If you have any questions, remember you can keep asking questions by the chat box, so the Q&A box. And now we'll go on, we'll introduce you to Peter Howarth, who's our English tutor, who's here today to talk a little bit of an intro to English at Queen Mary. So we'll let him carry on.
Hi, everybody. I'm Peter. I've been thinking for this about what I would want to say to anyone who is just coming to the end of A-levels, waiting for their results and thinking, how can I best prepare for my time at Queen Mary? I was thinking back to my own days and I thought, when I was doing A-levels, we were just stuck inside a classroom all the time and we were reading these books and they just seemed to be about the books, and we never talked about how they connected to ordinary life or real life. You just kind of ticked the assessment objectives and went on. And really, I think the whole thing about the course at Queen Mary for English is that question of how literature and regular life connect. So I was thinking about the best way to prepare for coming here. And I would say it's to kind of do things that can reconnect you, reconnect literature and life. If you're in London, we're going to teach a course called London Global. And if you live in London, one of the best things you can do is go for a walk in the city and notice what you notice. Notice the traffic, notice the sounds, notice the streets, notice the confusion. On London Global, we're going to be asking how this city has connected up Chaucer's Canterbury Tales or Shakespeare's Hamlet or T.S. Eliot's The Wasteland or John Milton's Paradise Lost or Sylvia Plath's Ariel or Ben Okri's The Famished Road. This is the city in which they were all written, and the question is how these great works got inside the city. How's the city got inside them? It's really obvious the way that the city gets inside someone like Dickens, for example, but how might it get inside something like Milton or somebody like Okri? So in that course, we're going to be taking you for walks and for trips and also reading some of these great works and asking how cities work with speed, with traffic, with globalisation, with cultures living side by side, with empire, with power, with money. So it's a great way into studying, and I could really recommend the best way to do that is just to get used to London. So if you're in London, then I just recommend taking a walk. Sounds simple, but there it is. You'll also be doing a course introducing you to poetry. My experience of poetry at A-level was pretty dismal, I have to say. Again, we were just reading it on the page, and then we wrote about it. My recommendation here to prepare would be to do the opposite of that. Go to a gig, go to somewhere that puts on poetry readings near you. If you are a poet, especially, have a go at performing. If you want to look online, there's lots and lots of performances available on YouTube. It seems that social media seems to be the best platform for contemporary poets, and that's something we're really going to focus on in the course. So if you like, take a break from words that you look at and think about what happens when you listen. How does that reconnect poems to, obviously, to sound, but the room, the artist, the audience, the situation? Those are the really critical things that we're going to be thinking about on the poetry module. Shakespeare, we're going to be doing lots of Shakespeare. And I have a specific recommendation from the Shakespeare teaching team. Please, they say, will you buy a copy of the Norton Anthology of Shakespeare and read Romeo and Juliet and Midsummer Night's Dream. They also say, please, can you save the date of the 25th of October? Because everyone's going to the Globe that day and there'll be a chance to see a performance as it would have been originally, to go back in time. Hundreds of years and experience as it was. I would also recommend seeing some performances that are completely not chronological, that enjoy films that deliberately reset the plays, that cut them up, that mess around with them, performances that deliberately modernise them, because comparing the old and the new is going to be a very important part of the what you do with Shakespeare. Finally, I do have to say, I have a couple of book recommendations for you if you're thinking, oh my word, I'm not sure I can handle the tradition, the transition into first year. I would really recommend reading a good source of intellectual history. How have we got to where we are? One I could strongly recommend is by a chap called Smith, Charles Smith, and it's called Modernity and Its Discontents. It's published a couple of years ago by Yale University Press. And it's thinking about how modern life is, how we got here, and what's great about it and what's not great about it. And that's a really, really good background to what you'll be studying on your course on literature and theory, because it's asking the same kinds of questions. What is so great about being an individual and choosing, and where are the tension points with history, culture, tradition, inheritance, all that kind of stuff. I'm also a big fan of Charles Taylor's old book, Sources of the Self, a kind of guide to how our modern state of mind came to feel normal. If I could look back and tell myself, my younger self, two books that I wish I had read, Taylor's Sources of the Self and Smith's Modernity and Its Discontents, they really would have set me up very well to understand what an English degree is all about. So there you have it. A couple of book recommendations, but really the recommendation is get out, get about, think about the city, go to some performances, hear some poetry. That will be the best way of connecting literature back to life again, which is what you need when you come to Queen Mary. I'm going to hand over here now to Shane. Shane is our drama admissions person, and he can give you some great advice about what to do for drama.
Hello, hi everyone. Should I flip this?
Yeah.
One more?
There we go. One more.
That is me on the screen. I'm Shane Boyle. I'm a lecturer in drama, and I'm going to be talking a little bit about what to expect from the first year curriculum. I will be focusing mostly on those of you who are doing single honors degrees, but I will just in drama, but I'll mention a little bit about the joint honors degree in English and drama as well. So the first year of the drama degree is really a chance to bring everyone up to speed and make sure everyone is kind of on the same playing field and has the tools that they need to thrive and succeed on the rest of the degree, especially in years 2 and 3. To that end, the first semester is really oriented to introducing you to London, introducing you to Queen Mary, introducing you to the academic skills that you'll need to write an essay, format a bibliography, all of that fun stuff, as well as really introducing you to the methods and ethos that guide how we teach practice at Queen Mary. So in the first semester, the core module for our entire curriculum that we've been teaching for years and years and years is called London Culture and Performance. This module is a seminar module that meets for 3 hours each week. Normally seminars later on in the degree just meet for 2 hours, but this seminar meets for three. That's because in addition to examining a bunch of really, really interesting issues related to theater and performance. This is the module where you will also be taught a bunch of really practical skills that will be absolutely essential for the rest of the degree. So London Culture of Performance, what this module does is it introduces you to the larger world of performance here in London. Some of you might be coming to Queen Mary having grown up in London. Nonetheless, you'll be seeing London from a whole different perspective through this module. The module, in addition to attending performances in London, you'll be doing performance walks and tours. You'll be looking and considering performance art. You'll be thinking about how London has, how performance has figured into the history and the very kind of architecture of London itself, and a bunch of other really exciting, interesting things that will really get you used to and comfortable seeing theater, seeing performance, experiencing art and culture in London. The other half of this module, we use this really exciting material as a way and as kind of a lure to really make learning practical skills that are, like I said, essential to the rest of the degree fun. So in this essay, in addition to studying a wide array of performance forms, you'll also be writing essays, giving presentations, learning how to write a footnote, format a bibliography, all of that other stuff that you will need for the rest of the degree. So that is the seminar module that all single honor students take in the first semester. In addition to that, students will take two practice-based modules. The first practice-based module is called Power Plays. This is a module that is very much about thinking what one can do with a performance text. Okay, so in this module, you will be studying three plays. I think the teaching team is still figuring out exactly what they want to do, but the idea right now is to teach a play called Notes from the Field by Anna Deavere Smith, to teach a play by Carol Churchill, as well as possibly another play by an American playwright named Brendan Jacobs Jenkins. If you aren't familiar with any of these writers, I highly recommend you give them a quick Google search. It will make you extremely excited for this module. You'll study these three plays. You'll think about how they're made, how they're constructed, the conditions under which they were written and seen. But instead of staging these plays in this module, you'll be using performance as a way to respond to these plays, to research these plays, to think about them in a different way than just reading them and staging them as the author might have intended. You will be, in short, creating provocative responses, replies, adaptations to the materials and issues that are engaged with in these play texts. Okay? The third module that you'll be taking in the first semester is called Making Theater and Performance. This module is very much about thinking about the methods that artists use to create work. So students will be divided up into small groups, each of which will be led by a different member of staff. And each member of staff will be teaching their group the particular method of a specific performance group, such as complicité, frantic assembly, maybe forced entertainment. It changes year to year, but those are some of the groups that we've used in the past. And over the course of the entire semester, you'll be watching work by these groups, you'll be studying their work, and you yourself will be trying to figure out what it is that make these groups tick and what actually is at the core of their method for making performance. And you yourself will then make performances following these methods. This module is not just about getting to learn about some really, really amazing artists, but it's really meant to get you thinking about what it requires to develop your own method of making performance that will then be useful for future modules on the course. In the second semester, I'm not going to go into depth about it right now, but all single honor students will take a practice-based module called Beyond Acting, which basically the concept of that module is you're in a theater space. What sorts of fun, interesting things can you do when you're in a theater space besides acting, i.e. besides pretending to be someone else? Okay. In addition to that, you'll be taking two seminar modules, one called Interventions, which is about applied drama and activist performance, thinking about what theater can do when it leaves the theater. And then the final seminar that you'll be taking in your first year is called Spectatorship, which is really about thinking about histories of spectatorship, what it means to consume theater, not just today, but also historically. To prepare you for the first semester, we don't have any set reading lists or anything like that, but we do highly recommend you go see some performance this summer. We also would really recommend that if you're keen to check out a few books. Each of these books is really, really affordable. They're part of a series called Theater And, which is published by the publishing house Palgrave Macmillan. And each of these books is only £6. And we highly recommend you check out three of these books. The first is called Theater and the City, which is written by Jennifer Hardy, one of our professors in the department who teaches London Culture and Forms. This will give you a great introduction to that module, as well as the methods and approaches that she'll be using in that seminar module. In addition, we also suggest you check out the book Theater and Race by Harvey Young. This will be especially useful for the first semester practice module Power Plays, because that module, in addition to engaging with performance texts, is really interested in issues around power, identity, specifically as it has to do with racial difference, gender discrimination, sexuality, and disability. And that brings me to the third book that we highly recommend you check out. It's called Theater and Disability by Petra Cuppers. And it is a wonderful introduction, not just to disability and performance, but also to the larger assumptions that we ourselves bring in to the theater. And some things that actually we don't oftentimes reflect on. Okay? So each of these books, Theater in the City by Jen Harvey, Theater and Race by Harvey Young, and Theater and Disability. Each of them cost, I think, about £6. They're very short. They can actually be read in just a couple of hours because they're not very long. Small pages, big type, that sort of fun thing. But that, if you are able to check out even just one of those, that will get you ready to start the semester. That's all I have to say. We're going to have a Q&A and a short... Actually, I'm going to hand it over to Rupert, who's going to introduce what's next.
Thanks, Shane. Wow, I'm excited. So you guys are probably mainly English students. So if Shane has lit your fire for drama, remember you can do drama modules. So choose them if you want to do them, especially in year two and three, where you get a little bit more choice. And for now, and we're doing a slight change of plan, which is... that we're going to have a Q&A, but we're going to do it with all three of our guests. So we have T. How do you say your name?
T is fine.
I just say it's a lot easier. So we're going to have, if we can ask Shane, Peter and T to come round, and we'll just start a little Q&A about the sort of general experience. We don't have our English ambassador, unfortunately. The heat has claimed them. So we're going to have a Q&A with these guys, and they have all, T's studied here for how many years now?
Two years.
So she's got 2 years of experience that you're very welcome to make use of. I'll check you guys all in focus. So there's a bit of a chair in the way. Oh, there we go. Cool. So if you guys sit just so you can see the camera. So if everyone's still there, maybe you could just start a bit of conversation. If you could just introduce yourself, T, and then we'll have questions.
Yep, so I'm Tirza Abrahams. So I am about to go into my third year. I'm a single honours drama student. The course has changed ever so slightly since I did first year. But I have experience of LCP, that Shane was talking about,
London
Culture and Performance and Making Theatre. Some of the other modules have changed, but what I found while being at Queen Mary is just how focused it is on how much of an effect performance can have on a community, or on a city, or on an individual. So it's looking at performance not only in terms of making it, but also at how much of an effect a specific piece of theatre can have. And sometimes that's on a small scale, so it can change an individual's habits or their way of thinking, or it can also work on a much larger scale. And it can also be brought in, as Shane mentioned, in interventions in an activist way. So I found this, while being at Queen Mary, this is a thing that I've become very passionate about and that I didn't know about until I came here. There's also a lot of extracurricular activities that you can get into, specifically the Queen Mary Theatre Company, QMTC, who do, I think it's over 40 shows a year. So compared to other theatre societies that I know of, where you might do one or two big productions, instead QMTC works on a festival basis. So every month or 6 weeks, they have a new festival. Each festival has about 4 to 6 shows, depending on the attendance and the amount of pitches that they have. But this means that there are so many opportunities for you to get involved. You don't have to be a drama student to be part of the society. We have law students, politics students, lots of English and drama students, but anyone can come and join, whether that's an undergrad or a postgrad. There is so much opportunity to get involved, both if you want to write, direct, act, or stage manage. You can learn about lighting. If you want to learn about costume, I'm sure someone would happily help. But it's a very good source. And every year they also take up 4 shows to Edinburgh Fringe Festival, which is, it's amazing. Go up for the last 2 weeks and you work in a rep basis. So each day there's 2 shows and then the next day you switch. So you do 6 shows each altogether. And I know that the people who are going up this year, they're already well into rehearsals and they head up on around the 10th of August, I think. So if you're in Edinburgh for Fringe, please do go and see them and show your support.
Also, did anyone have any questions?
Any questions?
Maybe you could talk a little bit about, until we get any questions, maybe you could talk a little bit about what it's like starting it, any advice you'd give people. And maybe you guys could maybe talk about your personal tutor. That would be really helpful, I think, to introduce both of those things. So maybe, what's the first few weeks like?
So the first few weeks, they're all go. So you have welcome week, which is basically a week or a week and a half of activities to welcome you to the university. So if you're living on campus, you move in. Then on the first day, there's normally, for my year, there was a big party in the student union that evening. You also have the welcome fair, which goes on for 2 days where you can go around and see all the different societies or sports clubs that you might want to sign up for. You can also get lots of free things and free pizza normally, which is wonderful. You just get an understanding of all the different things that are going on at the uni besides your course. Then you start getting details about your course through. You have an introduction to your course, which is normally a very short lecture, and you're told about your timetables, and you're given a very short tour of the buildings, understanding of all the resources that we have, and you're also introduced to your personal tutor, which I don't know if you want to go into more detail about.
Yeah, so I'll speak about the drama side of things. I think it's slightly different in English, but it's not static. Yeah, it's not that different. So every student in the School of English and Drama is assigned a personal tutor, and you get to know that personal tutor in a very fun way during Welcome Week. And he was just talking about Welcome Week. And the way you get to meet them is we take you on a tour, and you get to learn from us all the exciting and important locations on campus, from advice and counseling center to the Great Hall to a bunch of other places that I'm kind of forgetting right now. But it's always a good way just to kind of meet your tutor in a different way. But basically what the personal tutor, the function of your personal tutor or personal advisor is to be kind of the first place to go if you need to, if you need anything related to the course. If you have any questions about the about your module timetable, if you have any questions about library access, if you need to know about how you've unfortunately had to submit a piece of work late and you want to know about kind of the process for getting any penalties waived, anything like that, they're the person that you go and talk to. They're there
We've got a couple of questions.
Oh, okay. So I will stop.
Cool.
Well, I have one more thing to say about the personal advisor, personal tutor system is, I mean, it's even though you're assigned a personal tutor, you might be taking a module with another lecturer who you get along with really, really well, and you are more than welcome to go and speak to them with any questions that you have. Even though you're given a personal tutor, here in English and Drama, we're always, like, I'm always speaking with students who aren't my advisees about things related to the course. So that's just one thing, other thing I know about that.
Okay, so we've got some questions by chat then. Just to say to everyone, I'm not on camera, but hopefully you can hear me. You can also speak if you want to speak your questions or leave little gaps, just turn your microphone on. But the ones we've had through text are, the first one is about the transition from A-level into the degree. So maybe Peter, you can talk a little bit about that. The question is, how is the transition from A-levels to degrees, mm-hmm. to the degree? And what would you say the key differences are?
Maybe? Yeah, sure. What a great question. I think the main thing is it just becomes so much more interesting, so much more fun. Because the A-level syllabus has been kind of ratcheted down to a degree of tightness by most of the exam boards. So that there are only certain things they're allowed to teach, because only certain things will get recognised and rewarded. And degree English opens up all the questions that have probably been suppressed by that process of just getting you through the exam. In a typical A-level thing, you study a text and study it intently and think about its metaphors and think about how it all connects together on its own terms. But not so much do you think about how this text performs to you, what it feels like to read to you. You don't so much think about the author's journey towards writing it, how it got from, say, the piece of paper to the printed text and then onto the syllabus and all of the journey of publicity and recognition that goes with that. And you really don't think about the big situation of this book. The big questions like, why do A-levels exist? Why is literature supposed to be good for you? What is this thing we call identification? When you read the character and think, oh, I recognize that, because it wasn't written for you, and what kind of pleasure and what kind of pain is involved in all that sort of thing. So if you like, it's kind of uncorking all the questions that you haven't been allowed to ask about books and writing and what's in it. English is just one of these octopus disciplines. It's got a tentacle stretching into psychology and a tentacle stretching into politics and a tentacle stretching into philosophy. And a tentacle in law, and so on and so on. And that's one of the reasons I absolutely love it, because we have a strange situation where books, writing, art, they're considered both very, very important. That's why the government thinks it's a good thing for people to study them at A-level, why English is still a core subject. And yet at the same time, they're marginal, you know, they're for weirdos. They're not on main stage. They don't seem to be earning people massive amounts of money unless they're very famous. They're supported by a kind of loyal fan club. So what is it about this thing that is both so important and yet, you know, authors are not the big earners in our society, they don't get to run the government, etc., etc. What is this thing that we call literature? Why are we so interested in it? So if you like, that's the big intellectual answer about the transition. The transition itself, I guess, will happen to you. But I just found it for myself, like having being allowed to take that lid off and really understand why these books that I really liked were so important.
But I think the other thing, in addition to the intellectual transition, is just, you know, the practicalities of how you're taught and how you study it. So it will be much more self-directed. You're in class, I think, a lot less. I'm from the United States, so I didn't do A-levels, but from what I hear, that's the case. T, maybe you can talk about the kind of more practicalities.
Yeah, so it's much more independent, both in terms of learning, as Shane was saying, but also if you're moving out for the first time, learning how to use a washing machine and how to cook for yourself. And I
still
think,
don't know how to do that.
No, yeah. Neither do I, but that's all things that that I think some people focus on and some people forget. And also it's brilliant because you've got people coming from all different walks of life at different ages. I had a couple of years out between A-levels and uni, whereas a lot of people in my course came straight from A-levels. So you're meeting people who have come from completely different backgrounds from you. And so your eyes are being opened in that way, and also what to do when you only have a loaf of bread left and nothing else. And then also in terms of learning and not having someone forcing you or being over your shoulder and telling you to do your reading or telling you to make sure that you get to class on time. And that's all things that I think you have to take in your stride. And yeah, they're things that you have to kind of remind yourself to do, but it does come very naturally. I found with everyone that I've been surrounded with, they all just seem to have taken it to water very, very easily. But I think, yeah, they're things that you don't realize that you actually have to do for yourself until you're doing them. Yeah, I don't know if that answers the question, but.
That's lovely. And we've had one more just in from Cassandra. He's saying, how many texts do we study on average per term? So we might not be able to answer that exactly. It's kind of up to you how much you're going to read, but there's definitely some set texts, perhaps more in English, but there's definitely some in drama. So maybe talk a little bit about the amount of texts you're going to be reading, or maybe per module, an easy way.
Yeah, sure. Obviously, that varies according to the module, Cassandra. For something like poetry, we give you a module reader, and we got fed up with the old one because it was published by people who just put really boring poems in, and so we made our own. And that would be maybe 7, 8, 9 per week to read. For the course on theory, we'd be asking you to read something like Mary Shelley's Frankenstein, and then alongside that, 3 or 4 pieces of criticism. That will be over a kind of 2-week period. So you might read Frankenstein, and you would, alongside Frankenstein, you'd be reading some feminist criticism or some criticism about technology and its relationship to literature, and maybe with the politics as well. That would be that there. For Shakespeare, as I say, I mentioned Romeo and Juliet and Midsummer Night's Dream. Those will be the main texts for the first couple of months, of course. But of course, it's not like you just read those. Each week, there will be pieces of criticism to read, people talking about the history and background and performance and adaptation and appropriation of all those texts. The way the university works it out is that each module takes you have between 2 and 3 hours of contact time, and then to back that up, you can reckon on about 7 or 8 hours of reading time per week. It doesn't always work like that. Sometimes it's no problem, and you've done all your reading quite quickly. Sometimes it just takes ages, and when you get onto those Victorian novels, I mean, they weren't made for university study. They're monsters. And so it's a really good idea, especially over next summer, to set aside some time to for the really big 3 decades. There's a huge amount of reading for English, but we're very aware that students do get overloaded. We know that it's normal for students to have to work as well, and so we've actually redesigned our whole first year to make sure that we to make a kind of curriculum which we think is doable and reasonable and extremely interesting. So I hope that's part of an answer for you.
I'm on the drama side of things. I guess I'll just speak to seminar modules. So it tends to be that in a seminar module, in the first year, each week will be oriented maybe around one performance example, and then in class, the lecturer will bring in other kind of side examples that they can speak to. So performance example might be something that you've watched online, it might be a play, it might be something that you've gone to see as a class, but usually you spend one to 2 weeks there, and then alongside, similar with English, in addition to kind of that, the performance example, you might have some criticism, some theory, some history to read alongside it. That applies mostly for just kind of the seminar modules. the practice-based modules, the way in which assigned reading and performances go, it really varies by module, and oftentimes it's heavier early in the module as we're trying to introduce you to a bunch of different kinds of work, and then later on the assigned readings and viewings oftentimes become more recommended according to how your group or how your own practice is developing. Where it'd be like, oh, so you're doing a lot of things with, I'm going to come up with a really bad example, with like video cameras and eggs. You might be interested in this like artist or something like that.
So it definitely, the reading gets more every year. So I actually got more surprised by it going into second year after first year. Mm. I was like, oh, wow. And I do work alongside. And so I work every evening and both days on the weekend. And it also, yeah, it's very much about setting time to do your reading. So I'm now very good at reading on tubes when I'm going to and from work. So that when I get home, I can go to sleep and be fresh for the class. But I think it's with drama in particular, there's also, I found like an understanding that you're going to see stuff on your own back. So, but that doesn't necessarily have to be a very expensive ticket. It could be something that's £5 at a local theatre, or going to see a new film that's come out, or a really good Netflix series or something like that, and kind of keeping your hands in the making side of it by watching things as well as doing the reading specifically for your modules. But I think that is more to an individual's discretion. So I tried and still do to see something new every week, even if that's me watching like an episode or a documentary of something that I'm interested in, as well as doing my reading, so that my performance side is kept up by me watching that, even if because some of the performance modules that you can take, the practical modules, are focused either more on writing, or there's an action design module that's about lighting and kind of production behind the scenes stuff. So if you're taking one of those, then it's really good to keep in your hand in the more practical stuff if what you're doing is more theoretical.
Yeah. Probably worth adding too, one of the things I find myself doing as a personal tutor, sometimes helping people navigate this. So, you know, you've just been offered extra hours, you could really do the money at work, but that might kind of really get in the way of the preparation for writing this or that essay. And sometimes what I do with students is to work out a way of managing the timetable, when to work when they do have time, and then to be off when they don't have time. So that, you know, the course, you have a reasonable go at the course, but doing the course is not killing you. And people have all kinds of circumstances and calls on their time. And one of the things your personal tutor can be good at doing is saying, well, if I were you, there's a handy shortcut here. Or if that's what you're interested in, have a look at this. And so we can hopefully be really good, kind of like coaches, for particular people finding their way through this course.
Yeah. We just have one more question from Cassandra, who's very keen. Which is very good. Thanks, Cassandra. So our question is around the kinds of things that you get assessed on. So what do you get marked on? So it's about outside of exams, which we have very few of in the department, in the school altogether. What kinds of things do we get? Do students get assessed on? And she's had presentations, but she's not sure about how they work and how you get assessed. So maybe if we could just talk about the types of assessment you'll get, just a quick summary, and then maybe, yeah, how they work, if there's like a special different kind of assignment.
Okay, so maybe I'll answer from English point of view. We always do a mixed forms of assessment. So we would ask you always to write some long piece of prose. That can be a formal essay. But it can also be an argument, a speech, a diary entry, a book review, other genres than just the essay. We're very keen on those. We're also quite keen on doing creative assessments. So in the poetry module, we will ask you to take a poem that you've been studying, take it apart and remediate it. Currently it exists as print on paper. What would happen if you turned it into sound? What would happen if you made a video out of it? What would happen if you made an interactive theatrical performance out of it? And so, you know, take it to bits and turn it into something else. And other modules have similar kind of assessments. What we try and do is build you up from writing short bits of prose into learning how to do longer and more connected things. Some people have done an A-level course in which they're expected to write 3,000 word essays. Most people haven't. So all the courses in the first year take you steadily up and getting used to what you have to be doing step by step. But we're strong believers in creative responses as well as critical responses. And the best assessments of all are the ones that get you to connect your own creative response back into the criticism and to see why how you felt relates to how everybody else felt.
In drama, we for seminar modules, there are kind of the standard academic essays as you might find in an English module. We too try to play with the genres of writing that you that we assign. So for instance, in a module called Interventions that runs in the second semester of the first year, that module ends with not with an academic essay, but an article that's profiling an artist or a social movement that might run in kind of a more popular venue like The Guardian or On the Blog or something like that. You still have to do research, but you don't actually cite that research in the text itself, and unless it's supposed to be kind of woven through the actual presentation in your article. We do presentations as well, so that might take the form of just, you know, standing up and reporting on an artist or on an event or something like that. But we also try to play with the presentation format. So again, in this module, as mentioned, the interventions. The other assessment is a group presentation, and I set that up normally as if students were on the television show Dragon's Den. In the US, we call it Shark Tank. Mm-hmm. And each group has to get up, and they it's as if I am running a funding agency, and I have a pot of money that I can give out to aspiring artists, and the students need to come and give a 10 to 12 minute performance presentation in which they try to get from me that money. And with their pitch of what they want to do. So in addition to coming up with a really good idea, they also have to come up with a budget, they have to come up with justification for everything, and they have to be able to defend that in questions as well. So it's kind of a more creative, fun approach to the presentation format. In practice-based modules, the assessments are surprise performance. Most often, especially in the first year, group performances, but also later on in the degree, and that might be solo performance duos, maybe other kinds of creative work, such as videos, playwriting. I know that you took the playwriting module. And assessment, I think, for practice, I think it's really, really important to note for drama that we don't base it on virtuosity or on skill, but we're really, really interested in what I call integrity. So making sure that you've done the work, that you've really kind of put in the time, that you've worked together, that you've taken a risk, and maybe that risk, in taking that risk, you failed, but unless you came up with something wildly interesting and fun and strange and creative and excellent. But again, we're not going to be marking you on how closely you compare to some like Shakespearean actor whose name I can't remember right now. but nonetheless, but you took theater writings, right?
Yes, and what was your assessment for that? So for theater writing, so it's a practical module in second year, and in second year you get to pick one of your practical modules. So it was one that I chose. And throughout the course, you are making a play. And so you basically send you submit a work in progress. So a draft of your play of a specific amount. However, what was good is it doesn't have to be from the start up to your third scene. So I did my start, my end scene, and about two scenes in the middle. And then alongside that, we staged like a work in progress showing of it with people in our class, and we can also get people from outside our class to come in, and you directed your own piece, and so you put it up so that your class and your module teacher could see what you were going to submit in the flesh and how you were thinking it would stage. You then also, I wouldn't say it was a review, but you write two short pieces about two plays that you've seen, and kind of it's titled like a page to stage. So you look at the text, and then you go and see the play of your choice and how that production or that director chose to kind of transport the text onto stage. So you look at how closely it was or how far it was from the text. And then you also submit a portfolio of 3 to 5 pieces of writing. So I put in extracts from my play submission that I can include or that I've written later. I put in some poetry and I put in a speech, but they really could be anything that was a piece of creative writing. And so that was really interesting because there were 3 completely different assessments to anything that I'd done on the course thus far. So I found that very interesting.
That's great. It's really good to hear something that. So there's one final question. It's a quick one about English. And it's from Alice this time. So it's basically whether we're going to get more than one book at a time, or is it, so in English, will we be given more than one book at a time, or will it be focusing on one before we get to another? Sorry, will we be given more than one, or focus on one at a time?
You take 3 modules concurrently. So there's one on Mondays, say, one on Wednesdays, one on Fridays, and you'll have something to read for each of those. There's 3 tracks at once going on. And then in each, as you follow each of those tracks, it's generally one book, and then a kind of cluster of stuff around that book to make that book make more sense. And then you move on to another book. So I hope.
And I'll just wrap up. Our internet, can everyone still hear? I'll just wrap up. And would someone mind doing the screen for me? You just have to tap it to move it up.
Yeah.
Cool. Hello again. Hi. So I'm just going to quickly. Yeah. Thank you guys. These guys are going now, but if you have any questions, we'll give you an email address at the end and we'll forward them on to these guys. So thanks so much to them. They're just heading off. The last few bits are just student support. So we've got loads of avenues of student support for you. One is advice and counselling. So you can get 6 weeks of counselling for free through this service. They're also really helpful for advice around money, getting jobs, things around visas or any kind of complications you might have studying in the UK. They're very open to talking to you before you start your course. So you don't have to already be a student or have a student card. They can talk to you now. So if you go to that web address, it is welfare.qmel.ac.uk. Also, there's the Dyslexia Disability Service. So it's really good to declare if you have any conditions which you're diagnosed with by a doctor, as this can really help you get extra support while you're here. So it's great to get in touch with them beforehand. You can have a meeting, talk about the kind of extra kind of support you might need. Mental health first aiders. So Queen Mary's a pioneer in mental health first aid. So basically people like me are trained to deal with mental health crises of our students, but also just to give general advice. So come and find people like me, or I have a colleague called Susie who will very happily talk to you and point you in the right direction for proper mental health support. There's also past mentoring, which is another thing, which is around students helping other students to do well at their work. So look into that if you feel like you might need a bit of extra support or motivation. It's a really good scheme. student health service. So that's, you can get a doctor on site, so you don't need to worry about that. You can register with them and your home doctor. So it's pretty useful for students when they come here, if you don't have a doctor already, a GP. And the last thing, writing support. So we do have writing support within our library services. So people can help you formulate essays, read your essays, proofread them. That can be really helpful. What's the next one? Society. So T's already gone through the Queen Mary Theatre Company. So that's a really great society where people go to the Edinburgh Fringe every year and really enjoy sort of becoming their own sort of gang of like performers and makers of theatre and directors and people who do lighting, lots of things. It's a really exciting one. But there's also lots of other ones. So if you're not into theatre, there's things like English Society, which does a lot of sort of parties. And I'm sure we've just got a new president of that society. So we'll be organising lots of really cool events in 2019-20. What else? There's the Batgirl Book Club, if you're into kind of decolonising the curriculum, that kind of thing. That could be really interesting to go along and read a book and talk about it in your spare time. Student media is really popular with English students as well. So if you want to get into journalism, that can be your first steps into journalism. And they do lots of really cool events with people like the Times and Sky who come in and talk to our students and give you the lowdown so you can get a really nice job in that industry. There's a few other things like show and tell. So that's about inviting people in and showing what people do in the creative industries. If you could go to the next slide, thank you so much. Careers, I'll just quickly touch on this, as your parents might be stressing out about this, or your carers or loved ones, a lot of people are worried about employability and thinking about that. So it's worth thinking about it from the beginning if you want to be ahead of the game. So one thing would be appointments that you can have with a one-to-one advisor, so they can look at your CV, they can help you with applications. Also help you with interview practice, which is a really good thing that not many people do. So you can literally not be so scared when you go into interviews and be confident. And there's some other things there that might be of interest when you get here as well. And the last, I think this is the last one. So if you do need any more help from us, so we might not have answered all your questions today. We hope we've got to quite a lot of them. And thanks for those questions already. But we also have email. This is our phone number. We're on social media at QMULSED. We always say SED, so it's short for School of English and Drama, in case you get confused by that one. We use SED as like the short version. And also UniBuddy is where you can talk to current students who can give you advice about what they're currently studying. But apart from that, I just wanted to say a big thank you for joining us. And my name's Rupert. I emailed you about this this live chat as well, so you can always just reply to that email and we'll help you as best we can. But for now, I just wanted to say a big thank you again for joining us, and if you do have any questions or want to get in touch or talk to a student or our admission students, we're here. So thanks very much, and we hope to see you in September. See you there. Bye.